Miss Angela Greenig a very warm Rio Grande welcome this morning.
Thank you so much. Y'all can sit. It's a little hard to transition from ha to hello, I'm Angela Greenig. But you know, honestly, you can't separate the two. You have to be who you are. Amen. I will tell you this, a few things. First of all, my husband Larry sends greetings, and he had the best time last night. I said, what did you do? He said, I ate dinner and watched the media from here. He goes, I got so encouraged. He says, and I see Joanna's husband's a real good dancer like me. I'm like, mm-hmm. We're gonna pray for you in Jesus' name. I'm like, what? There is something that gets released when you are open and obedient to God. Like, you can't explain it. But you know what? You are called for more than what you are right now. I really believe that. I really have a word for this church. How many of you go to this church? Raise your hands. Put your seat belts on. That's all I'm going to say. Amen. Can I tell you this? I don't work for no man or no woman. I work for Jesus Christ. And I won't apologize for that. That's what I say to myself, too. Come on. But as I do open up, I have to be myself, so for some of you, do 5 Hail Marys and call it a day. But it's like, poof. But I've come to knock down the walls where Satan has had this church bound. God said, I am releasing a new wineskin with a new wine that is going to overflow the streets into the city, and it's going to go all over the world. You have no idea how big and how great God is, but how big the anointing is for in this house. Some of you may not like her. There's the door. Because you are not going to try to pay off by your tithe and by sitting here crying and whining. I'm talking to the world right now because I have people all over the world. People say, you have over 10,000 ministries. I'm like, oh my God, that was years ago. I don't know how many we have. Don't really care. All I can tell you is this. God is done with man trying to put the cap down on his spirit. We keep putting it down. And the reason that you had felt so much heaviness is because we are the ones that have to carry the weight. You may not like me. I don't really care because you don't make me. You don't break me. My haters are my motivators. Hate me all you want. You'll motivate me because at the end of the year, I'll have millions of souls will have come into the kingdom. And you go, well, geez, that's pretty a lot to say. You have no idea. You have no idea what God does. My husband made a couple comments I would like to bring in. He said yesterday, he said, that young man, is it Elijah?
Yep.
Eli. He said, you know, I liked what he said. He said, because you were the one that said this. Whew. But it has to do with when you touch one, you just can't believe how many people are being touched. And that's what you brought forth in the word yesterday. You brought that out when you said that. And Larry said, I picked it up immediately. That's what you brought forth. Is that, listen, we don't understand. Like, we had salvations at the mall yesterday. People got saved. I mean, come on. Can I tell you that people have forgotten that salvation is the greatest miracle still? It is. It's the greatest miracle. When you have been steeped in so much darkness, and then God brings you into the light, your whole life changes, and you're never the same. But why are we keeping quiet? If we have the answers, why? I have ministries in Pakistan, and I go into pornography conventions and preach Jesus. I have Folsom Street coming up next month. 600,000 people will be there. There are kids chained. I mean, it's the most filthiest, darkest thing. You don't even want to think it. And people go, why do you go in? And they go, how can you go in? And I said, because I see people dressed in robes of righteousness. I don't see them in the darkness. I see them with the light of God. They were called to walk into the light, but something happened somewhere where the darkness got them, and they settled for the darkness. And God said, but where there is an absence of light, darkness will prevail. We don't want to open our mouth because we never want to offend someone. Well, I would rather offend someone and have them not go to hell than to have them go to heaven. I'm so excited. I'm just going to ricochet a little bit and bring the word. Just a few months ago, I was at the Catholic Church, and I'm not Catholic. But that's favor. Like, I was invited. I've never asked a priest, but they invited me to come in, and I was able to work with four priests, but I'm training 10 priests in exorcism. If you go on Amazon and stuff, it says Angela Greenick exorcist. I didn't put that there. I'm just like, I'm Larry's wife. That's all I am. But that's what they say. But that's what I'm known for. That's why some of you are kind of feeling like a little creepy right now, because the demons are starting to go, whoa. I just have a way of doing that, not to be weird, but it just happens. But it really spoke to me, and I want to share this, and then I'll shift it. But I went there, and right in the middle of Mass, I got to read the Mass and stuff, which is not normal. I don't think so anyway. I don't think it is. And as he was reading the Mass, the Father stopped and said, Angela, I have a word I need to bring out. I'm like, oh, okay. I figured it was normal. I heard that was not normal. And he said, Angela, God said that he has called you to be a bridge builder. And you're going to, my call is to go and build bridges where planks have missed. He said, you're called to build the bridge, the repair of the paths. And he said, and you're going to see, he said, but it has to do with the Catholic and the Protestant church. I'm like, oh, okay. So I'm like, God, you always show me signs in the natural before the morning, in a paper or in the skies or whatever. I always have a sign from the Lord. And what ended up happening was, hours later, and it's on CNN, but they had the Catholic Church, the Protestant Church, and the Orthodox Jew was standing at the tomb of Jesus Christ in Israel. And the roof is caving in. And God says, do you not see it's a prophetic word from me? He says, I'm going to crash down on every denomination. I'm going to crush it. I'm going to crush it. And they have a king that's going to rebuild it. And he's not saved. He's not whatever. No one knows what his, quote, denomination or what he is, what he believes. But he is footing the bill so that the cave can be restored. And the Lord said, it's a prophetic word for a timeline right now, says the Lord. It's right now. You can try to crash down in this house or in the churches that you go into, but woe to you who come against the priestly prophetic anointing. He says, you don't want to touch my anointed ones. We can't keep sitting around backbiting and murmuring and cursing one another to death because you think you're right. And the Lord says, you know, when you point your finger at someone, we point back, right? You're pointing back 3 to 4 fingers. God says, you better pay attention. But God is getting ready to blow this house up. I can't explain the fullness of it, but it is that big. And I'm going to take a few minutes and shift, and then I am going to bring forth a word through the word. Okay? Good. I will answer myself because that's all I ever do, as you will know. It's a little bit of a different atmosphere this morning, but tonight we are going to tear this place up. But I am being obedient because it's church. And there is a little bit of a difference. Okay. I'm going to read this word that the Lord told me to bring, which I gave to the pastor, of course, first. So give me 1 second here. First of all, I want to tell you, your worship is amazing. I was so excited to be in the worship. I was like, it wasn't hard. Like, you just come in and be. The chick that's up there singing, like, she just tweaked me out. Wherever you're at, honey. You better get some CDs made or something. Y'all better start getting some your own worship music together. Seriously, you are that good. Because you know what? God's looking for the anointing. You can play spoons up there if you want. God will put you out there. Don't worry about it. People laugh when I say that, but I mean it. It's not about performance. It's about the heart. If that's the case, I wouldn't even be up here. I'm like, I'm the least in your kingdom. God says, yep, that's why I use you. Because I just don't care. Because I love him, amen. But I'm going to shift this. Father, right now, in the northeast, south, and west, beneath and above the ground, enemy! Satan, you want to bow. We come against every curse, every incantation in the name of Jesus, whether it is from a Christian, a witch, a warlock, a soothsayer, no matter what it is, God, we bind up all works of darkness and we loose the angelic host from heaven. Father, I pray that your heavens would rip open the gates and that you would just flood us with your glory, that you would flood us with the light that only comes through the anointing of the Holy Spirit. God, I pray that we catch this today, what you want to get ready to do in the name of Jesus. And the body of Christ said, Amen to that. And then I am going to read the word. So here it is, though, because it's important. I can't move on until I am obedient to the Lord. Amen. Here we go. Ha ha ha. Breathe, Ange, breathe. I have written so many prophetic words since I've been here. When I get home, I'll get them all typed up and get them out in the prophetic networks. That's how much of an open heaven has been here. Even through the warfare, there is such an open heaven here. It's kind of like, what? But you know what? In the darkest times, that's when God is able to move, like, beyond what we could even think. Oh, goodness gracious. You have to give me a second here. I've got a new journal. It's not wanting to work, so, of course. But I want to make sure I read it the way God gave it to me so that I don't take away from or add into. Amen. I just get excited. I start looking at my stuff. I get just so riled up in the spirit realm. Like, God, help me here. Thank you, Jesus. One more, and then I'm just going to shift it. Okay. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord. God says, I'm getting her to release a sound from heaven. But it's a new sound, like the new wineskin with a new wine, a new oil. He said, I'm raising up a generation that are in the streets and they haven't even come yet. He said, there is something about being in the cave of intimacy. I can't get it out of my head since I've been here. He said, but in the cave of intimacy, he said, they're the ones I'm getting ready to be released. He said, they are in prayer and fasting. He said, and they don't want to be famous. He says, all they want to do is serve me. All they want to do is be a glory carrier. All they want to do is be a glory carrier for me. There is something so big about this next generation. There is a generation, and I just want to release this because it's of the Lord. But he said, there is something about your youth center. He says, I am getting ready to make it an epicenter. And there's a new ERA that's coming, a new era. God says, I am reestablishing borders. I gave this word to your pastor before we even spoke about anything. I said, I have a word for you from the Lord. But God said, I'm getting ready to blow this house upside down. I see a generation getting so rocked, so on fire for Jesus Christ, and they are your youth. I said, but they are going to be purebreds, not show horses, God said. And he said, there will be so many young people that are drawn into this church. He says, you have no idea what's getting ready to explode. He goes, I'm getting ready to shift this thing into gear. And when this gear hits, people are going to be watching and saying, well, how did they do that? How did they do that? But can I tell you how they did it? Because they had a true apostle, this man of God, that laid down his life for what's going on right now. And that's the truth. And what you don't honor, you will never have. But you will not dishonor her, because that's her daddy. And I think he'd whoop you, to be honest. But you don't dishonor his daughter. You don't dishonor that mother's daughter, because God said it was time to pass the baton. And it's time for the new wine. It's time for the greater revelation. God said, in the end days, I'm going to pour out my spirit and I'm going to let it rain. He said, it really does have to do with Joel right now. We went into the enemy's camp in the middle of the night. It says you went in, you went through their walls, and you pulled souls out of darkness into the light. He said, you brought in so many denominations were here Friday night. It was like not normal for here. Some of you, I just want to throw this out for free. You need to start coming on time. It's very offensive to God. I don't care what church you go to. Amen. It's very disrespectful. Yes. The Lord said, if you want me, you better start having a different attitude. Can I just say this? Whatever you put up on there, you were reading. I almost had a rapture moment back there a couple times. I was like, oh my God, I'm going to have houses. My bills will be paid. That's what I heard. And I'm like, no, my house is getting ready to get paid off. I'm going to have houses. I'm going to have this. I got real jacked up over that. I'm like, I'm taking that. Can I tell you something? I almost took a visitor packet, and I'll tell you why. Because I'm going to start praying that God's going to start shake, rattling, and rolling. And some of you are going to get rid of this dead wineskin and move out of the way. Because God's going to bring on fire people that are going to blow your mind. Of course, they're still in the gutters and drug addicts and needles in their arms right now. But I felt like God was going, come out, wherever you are, because I'm getting ready to come get you. God's getting ready to use you to go get them. if you're saved, then you're going to go to heaven. But what about the people that aren't? I share this real quick here, but when my husband and I went through our divorce, I didn't want to go back into ministry, and I really did. I stuck my fingers in my ears every time God told me to go give a word. I'm like, no, I went through the divorce. I'm trash, blah, blah, blah. And, of course, God restored our marriage. Amazing. But the point was this. I didn't want to go back in ministry, and I had two visions in two nights, and I saw so many people burning, and they were on this crazy conveyor belt. I said, what's that about? And Lord said, oh, so you want to keep your fingers in your ears? I'm like, God, I'm not good enough. I'm not a good talker. I don't even have English language, you know. English ain't my first or second language. I just have my own lingo. And I said, Lord, I don't have what that takes to do what you're telling me to do. He says, it's in you. The DNA is in you. It just hasn't come forth yet. He said, but you have to start persevering, and you got to press in. He said, if you want someone to pray for you, get over yourself, Angie, and pray for yourself. He says, if you have, and that's what he said to me. Can I tell you, when I went to Pakistan, which I'm going to show later tonight, the second time, I had a gunman up on the roof. When I went home, they told me I had colon cancer. I'm like, I'll be back in 22 days. I didn't tell my husband because he's a crier. So for 21 days, I have a flat roof. I just prayed. I said, cancer, you have no authority in my life. And can I tell you, it tried to grip me so many times. I was so sick, but we had thousands of people get saved, birth churches. I mean, it's just like crazy. It's like, and it's not hard. Because people go, do you know what you're doing? I'm like, yes. No, I still don't. I just know when God tells me to go, I go when I go. He says, just be the donkey tied up, and I'm going to ride you in. And can I tell you, when I got back home, I was violently ill. They've told me three more times since, and I've had breast cancer. I'm like, that's not happening either. And I do tell people, if I die, I'll bring myself back, because I know I can. You cannot tell me any different. But I believe it. See, we got to start believing God for the impossible. Everybody else can believe, and then we'll just want to kind of be on their train. But how about if you become the train and let somebody follow you and help them to get where they need to be? Everybody wants to be the superstar, but there ain't no superstar in this house but only Jesus Christ. He's the only shining star I see in this house. And if I lived here, I would come here and I would sit in the back and pray and clean the church, because I was already cleaning this morning. God, this just drives me crazy. Picking up stuff, I was like, Lord, this ain't my house. And the Lord said, yes, it is. He said, this is your house. If you see dirt or something, you clean up. So I love that. Because we're called to be servants of God. Get this today. God wants to get ready to shake this place upside down. And it's going to be all for one and one for all. And you're going to have the mindset of, how can I help you? What can I do to help you? How can I help you to get where you are? I just think that that's where God wants us to start going. I don't think, and I know it. You know how the disciples moved and breathed and had their way? Because God moved them. And I think that they were just as bad as we were, all the disciples and all the brothers in the upper room fighting. No, God loves me more. No, he loves me more. He loves me more. You have more of an anointing. You have more of this. Well, I ain't got that, and I ain't got that, so who cares? But I love Reese's peanut butter cups. It's like chocolate and peanut butter. You put them together, they are so good. I feel like Joanna and I are like a Reese's peanut butter cup. Because we're good together. We're different. Not really. But we're different. She just says things nicer. But I'm going to shift it now. I'm just joking around here, because I really have a word I need to bring. And then we're going to really start. But I just want to say this. After 35 years of being in ministry, I get very overwhelmed when I see that there's so much chaoticness in the church and the craziness, because of the places I go into. I expect it there, you know. I expect the warfare. I expect the different dynamics, right? But in the house of God, I see all the flags around here. I'm like, God, this house is called to the world, not nations, the world. What if you have people looking in to see what you're doing here? You don't think that God's not looking. He is. Pastor Joanna now has a TV program with us, and I will be able to help promote her all over the world. Can I tell you, the one lady we have on our TV, she's from, the story never will leave me to the day I die. And she is in Drochten, and she went to Romania, and there the women had lost their husbands from Kosovo, the war. And she was ministering to these women, 70, 80, and even older. And a woman grabbed this little potholder and started weeping as she prayed to receive Jesus. And it wasn't in HD or, you know, whatever. You could hardly hear it and see it. She did it on her phone. Can I tell you, I can't tell you how many people have been set free from that. Because here these women had lost their husbands, their children, their home, their land. But they've lost everything. And then God sends this little fireball, Pastor Yanni, and she goes there and starts to minister the love of Jesus. And then all of a sudden, there's a transition and they get saved. But I believe that's what's going to happen when people see your pastor. They're going to listen to the worship. They're going to want what you have. But I believe that God's shaking things here because he's getting you ready for what's coming. If you think the warfare has been bad, you have no idea what's getting ready to come. God says, we have got to enlarge territory. Every time you enlarge the tent pegs, if I'm in the natural buying land, I have to bring in a bulldozer and a people to kind of build. It's a lot of work. But today's word is this out of Nehemiah 6. You're up on your wall and you cannot come down. And people are going to try to sway you to come down, but you can't come down. Because your job is to complete the wall, put up the gates. Your job is to complete the temple. Your job is to do the work that God's called you to do. And I don't believe he's going to wait like 40 years, like in 52 days it happened. God says, I'm going to move so quick now because there has been an earthquaking, earth shaking that's happened here. And I'll tell you why it happened. Because we all came together as one. It wasn't me. It wasn't you. It wasn't you. It wasn't you. It wasn't you. It could be you. But it wasn't you. But I know it's you. But I'm telling you by the Spirit of God, he said, what are you going to do when you start to see this thing explode? What are you going to do? Are you going to embrace it or are you going to have issues? I'm asking you today from God. God wants to know, what are you going to do? Is your heart opened for change? See, we all the time want what someone else has, but when we have to start the change, then we just decide, I don't want to change anymore. God has called this amazing woman to now be the forerunner in this house. Her father and mother have passed the baton. But he's not done. Don't think he is, because I got news for you, he's not. But right now, tag, God says, tag, you're it. And this is her time to now pick it up and run. Because every generation has a different general. Every generation, you know that, right? And we got so far, but now sometimes you have to be able to go further. And you can't go further if you can only go this far. And so God's using the both of you to take it into the next part. And of course, that has to do with your elders, your leaders, your deacons, your intercessors. It has to do with the entire church house. But it's going to take all of you collectively to get to where you're going. And this is a word I'm going to read very, very quickly. In Genesis 11, God speaks of Abraham. But really, he talks about his father. Second here. I'm going to read through the word of the living God. In Genesis 11, here we go. I'll just give a quick, but it's in verse 27 through. But God has a son, Terah. He became the father of Abram, Nahor, and Haran. And Haran, of course, was the father of Lot. He said, but while he was there, his son died. Haran died. But see, God had called the father to step into the promised land. But something happened to the dad, and he wasn't able to go. And he passed the torch to Abram and said, you go now, because I'm not able to go in to where God is calling. And the dad, if you read it, you'll see it. It's in there. But he was not able to go in, and he stayed where his son was. He wouldn't leave his son. His son died, he stayed there. And God says, then I'm going to call you Abraham. I'm calling you Joanna, says the Lord. I'm calling you. And the Lord says, but Joanna, and for your, this is for you. So just know when I say you guys, it's you. He said, but the Lord had said to you, as you leave everything behind, jobs, different things, I'm sure it's been that transition. He says, and your people, and even some of the things of your dad and mom. He says, I want you to go into the land that I'm showing you, and I'll make it a great nation. And I will bless you. He said, I'll make your name great. Because you'll make my name great. He said, and you will be a blessing. And I will bless all those who bless you. And whoever curses you, God says, I will curse them. I'm not making this up. That was chapter 12, verse 3. And all the people on the earth will be blessed through you. And Abram left, and the Lord had told him. And of course, we know the story. He moves on. But this is the other part of the story. as they were progressing, and I believe that's where you're at right now, God spoke and he sent the three angels of the Lord. And of course, they were at the time with Sarai and Abram, but we'll just call them Abraham and Sarah, okay? And God spoke, and Sarah laughed and did not believe that God could give her a child. I believe there are people that have been around you that have laughed and thought that you couldn't do this job. But because you were pissed and now you're like Abraham, so you're stepping out. And God says, but daughter, come. He says, daughter, come. You know, he took him outside and he said, do you see all the stars in the sky? And the Lord said, it's a picture. So that you could go back and look at the picture and say, God, that's what you're calling me to go and do. And I believe that this weekend was to break open and shake open things so that you could go outside and see all the things that God wants you to do. Because the call is that big. And I know it's not been easy. Not just because we're women and we are cute. It's not just because sometimes you got to break it up a little bit. But it really is true. This is your time to step in. Your dad and mom have left a legacy, but this is your time to leave a living legacy for the next generation. And if God so be it, it'll be your children or the family for the next generation. God has something so big that he is getting ready to do that it is more than you can comprehend and think. But I want to encourage you today from the Lord, but you need to embrace this woman of God. The Holy Spirit's not male or female. I can back it from Genesis into Revelation to you anytime and prove to you through the scripture. It's about the Holy Spirit. But I think sometimes people have issues, not just with a woman, but they wanted it to be them. But God didn't choose you. God chose her. And you have been doing an extraordinary job. But God's really getting ready to blow this place up. And he's done. You know that, don't you? Okay, so I need you to go grab my tallit in the back room, but I have to do something from the Lord. It's in the back room where I've been at. Yes, you. Yeah. Go ask right outside the door. I want my tallit. Is there a tallit? Somebody got a tallit in here. Jesus, God. Come on. Chop it up. Let's go. I need the oil. Come on, come on. No, move. Jesus. Not fast enough, honey. Come on.
But I have to be obedient to the Holy Spirit.
All righty. Wait, my cakes are here.
Love her. I don't know what it is about this woman, except she's crazy like myself. Can you come up here, please? He's like, I don't want to be on TV. I don't really care. Sorry. It's important. They have no idea what I'm doing. It's okay. God does. But can I tell you, God's getting ready to take people in to a land they've never been before. And you're going to need a leader. You're going to need someone who knows what they're doing. Hold that, honey. Yeah. This one I've had prayed over by kings and princes, really. You come up here, and then you come up here also. I just want you to come behind them and hold this up. Because it's a prophetic act for some of you. You're going, well, geez, I came for Sunday service. This is service. Amen? Come on, just hold it behind them for right now. But the Lord said that my blessing... I'll put up a little higher. He says, I don't want to put it over, but God's blessing is not only on them and behind them, but it is over them and it goes before them wherever they go. But I want to make a declaration today. But God said, listen, you have to understand, I have drawn a bloodline in the sand and you are either going to step in or step aside. So I just want to say this, but how many come into this church? How many of there are? Okay. Well, how many of you believe in them? Raise your hands. But are you willing to get up and come lift up his arm? So I want you to get up. And you're making a declaration in the spirit realm today. If you are here in this house, lift up your, get next to him, hold up his arm. Is there anybody else? So I've got three people. Are they your, is she your pastor? Are they your leaders? Yes or no? Move.
Come on.
You don't understand, but this is like the roar right now. You are releasing a prophetic sign that God is looking down. And he goes, I see the stars that are in the sky, and I see what you're doing, and I am releasing the blessing. And you will always have more for you than those that are against you. But you must get ready for this next move, says the Lord.
You must get ready for this next move. Do not move at all. Please just stay here 1 second, guys. 1 second. If you don't go to this church, but you believe in these ministers, get up and come make the declaration. God says this day, he says, you will proclaim this among the nations. He says, but I am preparing for war. He said, this church has been under attack, but let the weaklings say that I am strong. Oh God, bring down your mighty warriors, God. Father, right now we want to decree, because Jezebel has run rampant, and even though they're out the door, Father, we come against every lie, every word, every curse that has come against this ministry in the name of Jesus, from mom and dad to these people here, to their children's children, God. We come against every curse, every lie. Satan, you will bow. You will bow, you will bow. I read it from the word of the living God today. God says, Joanna, you are like Abram. And even though you may have felt like Sarah at times barren, left behind, God said, daughter, I put this call on you now. My mantle and my mandate is on you now. And I want you to look around, both of you right now, and see that you have stars in the sky, but they're all around you. They are the people. And God says, and when the going gets tough and you are out in that land and you feel like you're all alone, God says, you will remember this day, because you remember that you are not alone, because I am sending in reinforcements. I am sending in enforcers. I am sending in warriors, ground troops, air troop, in the waters, in the trees. God says, I got angels just coming in. People are going to be coming in to lift you up and to serve and to help build the kingdom of God. Because the kingdom of heaven, it suffers violence. And what? Well, say that one more time. And the what? Father, we decree today, it'll be written in the law, the books of heaven, that you see your sons and your daughters that are standing here, and some can't be here, but I'm, oh my God. Look at yourselves. Look, there is a church that is released. And Father, I just want to thank you, because I know that you have called her to shepherd this church. But God says, daughter, you're a transformer, and you really are more than meets the eye. You have an apostolic anointing, and you have the anointing of a judge like Deborah. And God says, I release that over you right now and in you. That will increase beyond what you could ever think. He said, this is your time to run, and you will run well, and you will finish the race in excellence. And one day, from years from now, you're going to look back at this day and say, Lord, I see how we had to go through the barrenness. I see the times that I was up on that wall and I knew I couldn't come down. But God, you said that I was called for such a time as this. And so, Father, we just want to release. I need that shofar blown real quick here, please. The lady with the shofar, can you blow that? Let's go. I don't know where she is, but somebody get that shofar. Don't move. Keep praying. There it is. Show! Come on. Yes, God. Yep. That's what I'm talking about. So I want you to take a second now, look at each other, because you're held accountable. But is this your church? Yes. Again, is this your church? Yes. Are you willing to lay your life down for the sake of the call? Yes. Are you willing to serve Jesus Christ? God's getting ready to explode evangelism like you have never seen before. He's getting ready to release this place upside down. And he's looking for an army, soldiers of the light, warriors of the cross, that are not afraid to fight. As the Lord, this day in the book of remembrance, I know that you are looking and seeing. And this is really why I came here. This is why the battle was so hard before I came. The Lord says, she has no idea what you were doing. I'm like, thank God. He said, but today I release you into your destiny, daughter. Today, son, I release you into your destiny.
Father, we thank you for the walkers. We thank you for the water walkers. We thank you, Holy Spirit. Greater impartation, miracles, signs, and wonders. And just like you did with Abraham, God, you blessed him. And you gave him the promise, Isaac. And so, Father, I thank you. I see more churches coming out of here being birthed. And God said they won't be, you know, Ishmael, they'll be Isaac. And they're going to be healthy, and they're going to be a lot of them. And they're not just going to be in Texas. They're going to be all over the world. And it is that big. I don't say anything because I'm not going to lie. Jeremiah 23 says, woe to the priest, prophet, and pastor that would just put words. Because I said, God, you can strike me dead now because I have to stand before God too. But I'm telling you by the Lord, he said, I'm releasing Isaacs, and you will see them like the stars in the sky. And so, Father, we just want to thank you again for this time frame. I actually just want to cry and get into crazy worship and have fun because God said this is really a time of celebration because we're going into the promised land today. I'm very excited. I have never done this before. No, you're fine. Excuse me here, a second here. I just got to get through. Excuse me. You got to have a little bit of fun because people get all tweaked out when it gets real serious. But it is very serious. Each one of you are held accountable, by the way. I know you weren't expecting it. She's like, what am I going to do with this woman? But it's really from the Lord, and it's now. It's so now. Amen. And you'll see the changes very quickly. And it's okay if I just do a prayer. Father, ignite the fires like never before. I thank you for the strong tower. I thank you for this amazing man of God. I hear that someday when you fall down, you can run to him when no one else is around because this warrior's a child. And I just release that blessing now, Father, over this house. And yesterday is done, and even up until 5 minutes ago was done. But I hear the Lord saying, you know, don't allow the seeds that have been cursed to re-root and take root and take flight. He said, don't let that happen. He said, now we're getting ready. It's on. Amen. It's on. It's on. Amen. Come on, God. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. I know. Isn't God amazing? Well, that was my sermon. No, really, that was the word today. He says, you have to tell them. It went from generation to generation, and I'm blessing you now. I feel like we should worship or have some fun or something. Amen. Don't you? Can we do that? Okay, you do whatever you want.
Tonight we have people watching all over the world through live stream. And I want to give an invitation tonight. If you may be here in this building, but you may be somewhere else all around the world. But God wants you to know that he loves you. And that he knows right where you are and what you're going through and where you've been and all that you've done. And he says, don't worry about it. My blood covers it. Don't worry about it. My blood covers it. Now, that doesn't mean that we have grace to continue to sin. But we have grace to turn our back on sin. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. We were all dug out of the same horrible pit. We were all snatched from the flames of hell. We were all once sinners, but we can be redeemed through the blood of Jesus Christ. Is there anybody here in this building tonight? You don't know Jesus. Maybe you've heard about Jesus, but you didn't know that he loved you and that he wanted you and that he's choosing you. But he's choosing you tonight. He's putting his finger on your heart. And you feel it right now. Your heart's pounding. You might be shaking. You might even be crying. But you feel the power of God. You feel his presence is calling you to him. I want you to do what I did so long ago. I said yes. If there's anybody here tonight and you want to say yes to Jesus, you want to surrender your life to him and give your heart to him and invite him to come in and be your Lord and Savior, would you just come right down here in the front? Right here. I want to pray for you. And if you're there watching on the computer or on the TV, amen. Anybody else? Wherever you're watching, all you have to do is just reach out your hand wherever you're at. And you can pray right along with us. Is there anyone else who wants to receive Jesus Christ tonight? Now let me talk to another group of people. There are those who know Christ or have known him, but you walked away for whatever reason. Maybe hurts, offenses. Maybe you just got into sin. But the Lord is drawing you home tonight. He loves you. He wants to take you back under his wing because you're a son and you're a daughter. You know, there was a man in the Bible who had a son. And he said, "Dad, give me all my inheritance." And so his dad did. He gave him what was his, and he took off with it. And the Bible says that he spent all that he had on riotous living, on drugs, alcohol, women, you name it. He squandered it all. And one day, because he was so hungry, he took a job feeding pigs, which is the worst job you could get. And he was so hungry because nobody gave him anything, the Bible says. Maybe you feel like that. You're so hungry for more, and nobody is offering you anything. I'm offering you Jesus tonight. He's everything you need. And this young man that was feeding the pigs, he woke up one day and he's like, "What am I doing here? How did I get here? I had it way better at my father's house. I'm going to go back and I'm going to beg my dad to take me back." And that was his plan all the way as he walked home. "I'm going to tell him that I'm sorry, and I'm going to ask him if he'd just make me one of his hired servants." He didn't even feel worthy to be a son anymore. You are a son and you are a daughter. No matter what you go through, he will not leave you nor forsake you. And so he gets to the house. And the amazing thing is, his father was out there watching. It says that he saw him from a long ways away, from afar off. And you know what he did? That father ran out and greeted him and fell on his neck and kissed him. And he welcomed him as a son. He put his arms around him and loved on him. And he said, "Quick, bring a robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger, the ring of sonship. Put it on his finger." And he said, "Kill the fatted calf. For my son was lost, but now he's found. He was dead, but now he's alive." You might feel dead inside, but God wants you to know that you're a son and a daughter. And he says that you're alive. So if there's anybody in that category tonight, you say, "I'm coming back to the Lord. I'm like the son that went astray, but I'm coming back." Amen. We have this one young man here tonight. Is there anyone else? I know there's those that are watching live stream. Well, let's pray this prayer tonight. What's your name? Huh? Martin? Martine? It's good to meet you. How old are you? 10 years old. Definitely old enough to understand what he's doing. Amen. Well, let's all pray with Martine together. Would you say it out loud with me, everyone? Father God, in the name of Jesus, I ask you to forgive me of all of my sins. I ask you to wash me in the blood of Jesus and make my heart clean before you again. Write my name in the Lamb's Book of Life and take me to heaven when it's my day. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for restoring me and saving me tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
You know, I just want to say this. Those that are watching, can you give them your email or the website address here?
Yes.
Because they're watching live. So.
The website address is agcc.tv. agcc.tv.
Listen, we want to get resources to you, you know, help you to understand what's just happened. Because sometimes, you know, we're never losing that. But we want to make sure if there's anything that you need that you can email angelagreenick.com. You can email Pastor Joanna here, and we'll get resources back to you. We'll have people write, email, and help you through the times. The one thing I have found is that, you know, we get just enamored with emails. And people are, like, in shock because we send back emails if it's for healing, deliverance, finances, family, and we take the time to respond back. And that is like the greatest thing that I believe as pastors, as ministers, because so many times people feel like they've fallen through the cracks, and sometimes it does happen. But I really believe that there's a clarion call going out that we're going to be able to help more and more people. So I was here earlier today, of course, for service, and they said, when you come back to the visitor's booth, if you need a Spanish Bible or an English Bible, but I feel like we should just call that out tonight. And if you need anything, if you let us know, we'll mail it to you. I don't care where you're from.
Yeah. Yeah. If you don't have a Bible, you want a Bible in English or Spanish, just send it on our website. You can send your prayer requests in there. You can put it there. If you go to agcc.tv, you can click on prayer, like prayer request. You have a prayer request. And all of those are linked straight to my email. And so I read those personally and answer them. And then I forward them to our intercessors, and they pray for them. Yes. And anything that you might need, you can write through there.
See, that's what we do, but that's why it's so funny, because most people don't realize that we really do this.
Yeah.
And my prayer force is, we call them a stealth strike force, because my prayer force is my air force, because they are bombarding through. But listen, God is up to something. And, you know, I spoke last night a little about a little boy that got saved in revival meetings, just one little boy, and he was Dr. Billy Graham. And when that little boy stood up here tonight, I said, God, I believe we have another Dr. Billy Graham. And this young man is going to reach multitudes for the kingdom of God. Because if we had this whole weekend just for him.
Yeah.
Whatever you want to do. I really am going to do a little teaching tonight, actually. But I would like to be able to show my real mission thing, because it'll only take a minute. Okay, can we shift this? Listen, we've had such an incredible time. Where's Pam at? Can I have you back up here for a second? Pam, come up here with Joanna, please. We're doing a real quick three of us, if you would, please. Thank you. We just finished this great conference, and take a few minutes and share, though, because it's important.
We've had a tremendous weekend this weekend, and God had a plan.
to bring together the body of Christ in the RGV. So I know that a unity was established over this region. And I felt like we had tribes. My tribe was here, Joanna's tribe was here, and then tribes from all over this valley, from Mission to Brownsville, gathering together, and it commanded a blessing upon this valley. So there has been a shift in this valley. This whole region has been shifted because of what happened this weekend. It's been tremendous. And for me, it's the unity of the body of Christ working together. We're one body for this entire region. And the Lord says it's time to stop fighting each other and to start helping each other, to start pulling up other churches, pulling up other ministers. We're all on the same team, and we need to understand. But to me, that was the biggest blessing of this weekend. And all the deliverance, many people being delivered and set free so they can fulfill their calling. We're here for one reason, and that's to fulfill the purpose that we were sent here for. And so each of you have a purpose. And I felt like there was a resurrection power in this place, and the people that came got ignited and resurrected. Went out on the streets yesterday, and we had many salvations at the mall. They went over to the mall while they were shopping. They were also evangelizing. But it's been a tremendous weekend. Tremendous. And I just want to thank all of you also for coming. It's important that we gather together. It's important that the walls come down. And so it's just been a tremendous weekend. And I love Angela. I love when people come into this region, not just to blow in and blow out. But God sent Angela here 5 years ago. And we neither knew each other, and it was here, back there, that we had the first meeting. Never did I dream this, but God already knew that way back then. But a threefold cord, and I keep, Angela told me that before she came, and it's just stuck with me. A threefold cord cannot be broken. Now, how many of you are out there that are joining and linking together? How many are joining and linking together with as a part of the army of God? We're linking together to drive out the darkness as the light has blown in, literally blown in. Angela got off of that airplane. I went in to pick her up. It was really still, not a bit of a breeze, hot and not a breeze. We go in, we step out of that airport, and there was a breeze, a strong, strong wind. And I believe that's what happened. A wind has shifted a change in this region. So I love Angela. How many love Angela? And you know what? I love Joanna Walker. Gosh. I love this pastor who is willing and is opening her heart to work together with other churches. And so that's what we need to start doing. And let just let this be an example of what we're supposed to do here in this region. Yeah. Amen.
Well, I first came in contact with Pam in Florida. We don't live but 30 minutes away from each other, but had never known each other, never met each other. She went to a revival in Florida. I went to the same one, and I don't even know exactly how we got hooked up, but we met each other there, and then we said, well, let's keep in touch, and that's what we did, and so we formed a friendship, and I try to support what's going on at her church down in San Benito. She brings in many, many different people from the fivefold ministry. And I would take the intercessors and also people from the church. We'd take vans and go over there to her meetings and just be refreshed. I mean, people would come down that usually don't come all the way to the valley. And I mean, a lot of you know that. I mean, even in the secular community, I mean, everybody's like, oh, wow, if you can get a big-name band to come down here, right? And so it's hard sometimes to get people to come south of San Antonio because obviously there's nothing down here, right? No. I mean, the Rio Grande Valley is awesome, but it's like an untapped treasure. It really is. Once people come down here, they absolutely love it, and they want to keep coming down here. But the Lord has been partnering Abundant Grace with many different ministries over this last year. you know, not only with Pam and with Angela, but these are men and women that have been here to the church. And you know what they say? Whatever you need, we are at your disposal. Whatever you want, we'll come. Whenever you invite us, we'll be there. The Lord has spoken to our hearts. We love the people of the Rio Grande Valley. And all of them, from Chuck Pierce to Kent Henry, Jason Lee Jones. Gosh, who else has been here? A few. Oh, yeah. Wes and Hannah Pickering. Carmen was here, absolutely. But all of the different people that have come through the church in the last year, God has really put it in their heart for the valley. And they love it here in the valley. And it's not just Abundant Grace. It's not just the pastors here. It's all the people. It's all the people. And it's just so awesome, you know, to see the body of Christ coming together. You know, it's wonderful for another pastor to say, hey, if there's anything that you need, please call me. If you need prayer, because, you know, sometimes it's hard for pastors to confide in other people of the prayer needs that they have because, you know, everybody thinks the pastor ought to just be strong all the time, right? But we go through things too. Everybody goes through things. And so sometimes it's hard to talk to people, but you can talk to another pastor, somebody who's been through the same thing that you're going through. And so it's a huge support to network with other churches. And we had so many churches here. Friday night probably was our biggest group. I think we had about 12 or 13 different churches represented. It wasn't like their entire congregation, but a group of people from all the different churches. And I just want to thank Cross Church, whose worship team came and led the worship. That was awesome. And they're always more than willing to do conferences, and they've done many meetings for Pam down in San Benito. And, you know, just for churches to come together, what a blessing, right? I mean,
It really does. It brings hope. Because even as ministers, we do get tired. And we keep persevering and we don't stop. Because we can't quit. Because God's put an agenda and a mandate within our lives, but also yours. And I was really excited. Like, the warfare was so crazy coming in. And I slept almost 6 hours or 8 hours total since I've been here, since I flew in Thursday. But I'll catch that up later. But it was like so much warfare. And the Lord said, you have to pray. Because I kept praying. And I was in Ezra. And the Lord said, but I'm releasing a new mandate. And all the tribes came to hear what God had to say as he opened up the law through Ezra. And it was the worship. But the tribes came. And that's what happened Friday night.
Yeah.
The tribes came and there was unity, and it's really encouraging. And I know this may sound weird to some of you, but I really believe that God was up there cheering us on. Holy Spirit and angels and those who've gone before us, but they were cheering us on because they're like, they're getting it. And you know what? We're called to be a representation, but we're called to pass it on. And that's what happened. And I have to say this from myself because I do this nonstop. As soon as I get back to the airport, I'll be shifting and starting all over again. And I'm so blessed that God gives me the energy, but it's Holy Spirit and the fire and the winds. But I'll tell you the one thing that has really blessed me is that so many times when I go into regions and places, there's no unity with the leaders. You feel like you're disconnected. I have that sadly happen a lot. And it's very awkward. And God's been really saying this year, the last few months, he goes, I'm rewiring ministries and ministers, because even when you have 5 or 10 like leaders and people come together to minister, you know, it's just crazy and it's really sad. But we just stepped in, and we stepped in as one and we're leaving out as one. And actually we started our ministry here and we're already booking, and then Crossroads, they're going to be there with us next year, and a bunch of people are coming, you'll be there, and because we're going to be doing a meeting in Minnesota. Take a minute and share that really quick.
Okay. Well, I've been to a lot of conferences, and that's one thing. Years ago, I was hungry, and I wanted more, and I didn't know where to get it, so I started going out. Started going to different meetings with Keith Miller, different places, and I started getting, I went to Toronto and got touched by God like never before. I'd been a Christian 15 years, had an encounter with God in the meeting, and I left the room. I wasn't there anymore, and God was so close. I don't know if I went to heaven. I don't know where I went, but God ignited something in my heart that we need his presence in our churches. And so I've been to a lot of different meetings, but we had the first earthquaker. We called this earth shaker, but Angela and I were talking and it came out of her mouth, earthquaker. And I said, I like that. But we're going to start having meetings like this. Yes, we're going to have more here, but they're different. It's not your meeting. You just go sit complacent, but they're meetings where God is shaking people, waking them up, waking us up, and getting us out, doing what we're supposed to be doing. There's an acceleration. So I'm excited that we're partnering together. We're going to be doing these meetings in Minnesota in June. We've already setting dates in June. Yes, amen. But God wants his church shaken. He wants the church moving. And even these meetings, Angela said, since 1999, she's not felt warfare like this, because the enemy doesn't want the valley free, but too bad, because God does, and God had a plan, and he is happy with what happened this weekend. Okay, yeah, I mentioned this last night. I was praying, I don't know, Friday, Saturday morning, and the Lord reminded me in 1999, I was sitting out there somewhere, and Chuck Pierce was here, and he prophesied a healing revival to this region. And I tell you what, I drove out, and I got so drunk in the Holy Ghost, it hit me. And I realized, and the joy of the Lord hit me, and I drove all the way back to Harlingen, drunk in the spirit, thinking, gee, I hope I don't get stopped by a police or anything, you know. But that the power of those words went out into the atmosphere. And now 16 years later, we are on the brink, and it's even beginning. But there's so much more to come. This healing revival, and I see it in different pockets all over the valley. There are groups of people that are praying all over the valley. And then Chuck Pierce came back in 2011. We had the first Texas Ablaze with Keith Miller. How many were there? Was anyone there? He brought Chuck Pierce. And Chuck again prophesied a healing revival starting from Brownsville, a river of glory from Brownsville all the way to Mission. And that's when we started gathering together. Barbara Wintrouble came in a couple days later, prophesied the exact same word, and hadn't heard Chuck speak. So more confirmation. But since then, I believe we've started gathering together. There's many regional prayer groups, regional prayer meetings where people are crossing lines, joining together. And to me, again, that's a key, because it commands a blessing. It commands an open heaven. Yeah. So that's how many years later, 16 years later, this is now. The time is now. How many want that healing revival? Guess what? And God's going to use you. You're it. We're it. We're the church. And so these dry bones are going to live. These dry bones are going to live. And they're rising up. We hear the sound of the rattle as the bones are rattling, rising up, joining together. There's people coming, joining together. We're the army of God. And we're going to take this valley. Amen. That's amen.
Awesome. Are we good? Are we shifted? Or yeah, go ahead. Are you good? Okay. Oh my gosh. You know, I keep laughing because I'll be 58 really in a few days, but I just, I really don't know how I put out so much energy and fire, but I know when the Holy Spirit's here, but my body's like, you're so tired. I'm like, I know. In between, I've done television interviews like nonstop. And so who has time to sleep? You just go and shower and change and freshen up and come back in. But I want to take a minute here and shift, if that's okay, please.
Thank you. Can you grab my water or get me a water? Thank you.
Oh, thank you, Lord. Ha-ra-ba-ba-she. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for amazing grace. We just want to thank you, Lord, for your presence tonight. I thank you that every day and every time we step in, through the Holy of Holies. Every time I step into the pulpit, I feel like I'm having communion, seriously. And it's the most holiest time where you come before the Father and you lay it all down. Agendas have to be laid down. God says, you know, our way must be laid down. I love Proverbs 3. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. So tonight, God, we lean on your understanding. And we acknowledge you in all our ways, God. And we love you, Father. Amen and amen. Tonight, I want to just say a couple things here. Friday night was off the flipping charts. But that's how you have to do to break it in to come in. And then, of course, yesterday I taught on evangelism and prophetic evangelism and a few other things. And then we hit this. It was amazing yesterday. And then last night we just did our fun night, I call it. And I had testimonies. And you're going to be seeing a lot of these coming up on my channel, of course, on Pastor Joanna's and also for Pam. And you're going to be seeing them come up because this is our time now. We've really got to start to ricochet things within the spirit realm. And then I have to be very honest. I don't know what happened this morning. I was so caught up in the spirit. And I just kept hearing in Micah 3. And God says, but we're stepping into Micah 4. Thank you. And he says, it talks about being up on the mountain of the Lord and how all the rivers come together. And it just runs. And I was thinking this morning as I was starting to speak, I literally was translated out of here in the spirit realm. And I felt like I was above in a cloud. And I just was obedient to the voice of God. But I'm telling you, by the time we were finished, what had ended up happening was, because long story short, but Joanna and Jeff Walker, who this is their church from her daddy, passed it on the torch. And it's her time to go now. And I had to do it a new wineskin, that new wine. But the most amazing part was is that we grabbed the tallit. And the church came and said, but we're standing here with you. And I'm telling you, that was one of the most powerful things that, I mean, God always does power things, you know, but God works powerfully different every time. I don't put him in a box. I don't want people to put me in a box. I can be wild and crazy, and I can be just like I am right now. Inside, I'm wild and crazy, but you catch what I'm saying, right? But that was so powerful this morning. And my husband was watching, and he said, oh my gosh. He said, I felt like the cloud of witnesses looking down. He said it was, he said the way the camera was, he said, and it brought great hope. But I felt like that's what God was saying. It brought me great hope. If we don't embrace one another with those beautiful nail scarred hands, we can't keep throwing stones at each other of judgment and critical, you know, but to love and embrace one another. And to start stepping into the change. You know, in 1908, they didn't understand Azusa. But I believe it happened way before then. We just didn't know what it was. But they didn't get it then. You know, but then they started to get it. And people didn't believe that that was real, but now they do. They didn't believe that warfare was real, but now they do. They don't believe that women can be called in fivefold ministry. And sadly, some of you still don't, but eventually you will get the memo. But that we are here, and God has called us for this timing. It's just how it is. Because there is no male nor female in the body of Christ. It's Holy Spirit. I think I know my spirit. I have a word that God gave us a few months ago, and we preached it in Sweden, and it grieves God when that happens. And the judgment and the criticalness again. But today it was an epic moment. I like to call it, you know, it was an Esther moment in time. That's what I believe. When I came here, that's what the Lord spoke. I really want to just do a little word tonight. Is that okay? Good. Because I really would like to. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Just thank you, Jesus. You're so, so good. I just want to take a minute and open up at a Joshua 3, crossing into the Jordan. And early in the morning, a few days ago, Pam, Joanna, and Angela stepped out and all the tribes Friday night. And we went into the valley, not the Jordan, but we went into this valley. And he says, before they were getting ready to cross over, he said, within the next 3 days, you're getting ready to cross over. He says, but when you see me pass by the Ark of the Covenant, pass by, can I tell you, when you are in places where the anointing of God is and the Ark of the Covenant is honored, because not only do you have the mercy seat, but you have the Ten Commandments, you have the rod of authority, and you have the manna. And we know that the manna is the word of God, and the rod of authority is those in authority. And that you will follow and be obedient unto God. And what ended up happening was, he says, carrying it, and you will move out from your position. So Friday night, we moved out of our position, and we followed it. We followed what God had called us to do. He says, then you will know which way you are to go, since you have never been this way before. I'm telling you, it's been so epic here, but ain't none of you going to be the same again, I can tell you right now. Can I tell you, every time I do a meeting, I'm never the same. I glean and learn so much, and I will always learn until the day he takes me home, amen? We all will. But he says, then you will know which way to go, since you've never been this way before. And when it said to keep a distance between you and the ark, do not go near it. But I believe this is why. He told us, tell the people, you are to consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord is getting ready to do amazing things. And Joshua prepared the priests, and they took up ahead of the ark, and they did what he had said. Here's where we're at tonight. God says, I've taken you to a place that you've never been before. And you're crossing in into the Jordan. But can I tell you, you can't go back. You can't go back to dead works. You can't go back to trying to put this oil in that old wineskin. You're going to get so grieved because God has set so many of you free. And you don't want to put back on sickness. I hope it's okay. I'm using this. You don't want to put back on sickness. You don't want to put back on the lies and the fear and all these different things back on you, because God has given you his promises. And you were able to taste and see that the Lord is good. You were able to taste and know that there is more to God than meets the eye. You were able to experience the Holy Spirit. I heard people say to me, I have not felt that in years on Friday night. I have no idea who they are. I don't know where they came from. Whether they were here or the ones that flew in, I don't know. We had people come in from all over. But they said, I have not felt that here in this house in years. I don't go here. I've never watched a meeting. I don't know anything. But the Lord said, you have to understand it's always been here. But whenever the old wineskin has to be removed and a new wineskin comes in, when you pour it and it takes a little time to get it comfortable, it really does. And God now is ready to go full throttle. And he has got his commander-in-chief sitting right there. Because there's always got to be a leader. And, you know, my mother, being Indian, said we have too many Indians, and, well, we don't have enough Indians and too many chiefs. But God has really called this time, such a time as this. He said, this is our time. And Joanna and Jeff stepped in. And then this morning, God released it. And when the shofar was blown into their stomachs, I watched explosions. And I felt like it was in Genesis, where he says, and the angel of the Lord stood at the well this day, and you will never, ever again stop up the anointing. You will never stop it again, says the Lord. There won't be sticks and stones, because that's what happened. They kept building the wells, and then it literally stopped everything up. But the angel of the Lord stood there and said, the rivers of healing waters will never be stopped up again. It's not going to get stopped up again, says the Lord. That's what he says. So I'm going to finish up here quickly here. And he says, so I'm going to just jump a little bit. Boy, here we go. So the Lord said to us, he said, today I begin, he says, I've lifted you up so that they will know that I am with you, daughter and son, as I was with Moses. And he tells the priest to go and cross. And when you reach the edge of the Jordan waters, go and stand in the river. He says, come here and listen to the words of the Lord. This is how you will know that the living God is among you, because you are going to drive out anything that is an it. Always has to do with the enemy and the giants in the land. I'm not going on that road tonight, but I'm saying tonight this. We had so much deliverance on Friday, Saturday, and today that you can feel the shift in the region. You can. Like, there's been a mega shift here. And last night when we walked out, it was a lightning and then a thunderbolt in the natural hit. And early this morning, it started to rain. But I normally have that. But the winds came for one reason, because I really prayed and said, God, release the four corners, the four winds of heaven, and release the winds to start to bring exposure so that we can see how to navigate through these next few days, so that we are able to just produce the harvest that God is calling for. And then, Joanna, you spoke this morning about how if the wheat doesn't get taken care of, that the pigs will end up eating it if we don't get it, if we don't go for the harvest. That was powerhouse, by the way. Can you take a minute, share this really quick? Because we did this on TV. But can you?
Yeah. You know, the Lord is saying that it's harvest time. It's not 4 months till harvest. It's right now, like the Bible says. And you know what happens with wheat when it doesn't get harvested, or corn doesn't get harvested? Anything that doesn't get harvested, a lot of it will just die in the field. And a lot of that is used as pig slop. They make that into grain and pig slop. It's not edible for humans. And that's what happens. And we don't want that to happen spiritually to our harvest. We want a harvest. We want to contain the harvest. We want to bring in the sheaves, like we were talking about this morning.
You didn't know what it was. You said.
Yeah, the sheaves are the wheat bundles all bundled up together, bringing those in. So, you know, that's what the Lord showed me about the harvest, that the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. But we are the laborers, and the Lord is giving us a sharp sickle to put into the harvest now to begin to reap the wheat, begin to reap the souls of this valley. And it won't just be one person. It's going to take all of us. It's going to take all the pastors in this church. It's going to take all the people in this church. It's going to take all the people in your church and all your pastors and all your families to reach everybody, because each of us has a different circle of influence, as we've been talking about here on Sundays, that we all play a very significant, vital role in the body of Christ, and we have to do our part, or it doesn't get done.
Yes, exactly. But the reason that was so important, because when I was here on Friday night, I shared, can you hold that box, please? The next 3 years, God said, he said, grab the golden wheat. And he said, this is 2016. And I bought the wheat like this, but it has black, it's engulfed in black. And you can see it very clear. I'm leaving these for you, by the way. And he said, this is first year, second year, he said, but in the third year, and can I tell you, God really spoke to me this morning. He said, daughter, your third year is the third day. And he says, I have already started to release the harvest, and there's not going to be one pig that's going to get any of this. But he says, I have released the harvest into this house, because your daddy laid and your mommy laid their life down for this region. And we just read it because they went into the valley, and the Lord says, yes, because this is the valley. And you are in the valley. But a lot of you are in the valley of decision right now. The valley of Jehoshaphat, that's what it means, the valley of decision. And you don't need me to come, you to come, or Pam to come. You don't need us to come. You need to get up and listen to the word of the Lord and go, right? And then you're going to be able to start to see a move of God. But nothing happens without prayer. Nothing happens without prayer. Thank you. And so I want to shift this now for a minute here, because it's vital. I am so excited that this little guy got saved tonight. Seriously. You may say, well, he goes to church all the time with his mom and dad and grandmama and stuff. No. He may go to church every day, 7 days a week. But wherever that brother is that played the guitar tonight and sang Amazing Grace, when you started singing that, sir, you literally ripped wide open heaven. You did. And as you started to sing that song, it started to move. That's why I said to Joanna, we got to do an altar. We have to. Well, we just work together, but we're like, don't care who says it, but we had to do an altar call because the Lord, I really knew tonight that there's someone out there watching, and I saw a gun cocked to his head. And the Lord said, because you got up and gave that, his life just got saved. And I'm telling you, by the Spirit of God, we'll find out, because it's coming in, because we'll find out what it was about. And don't think it's just on the one, because it could have been 1,000 people. No, in Jesus' name, but you understand what I'm trying to say here. But it's so important, because God says, you don't understand, you have crossed in to get ready to go. But now we got to shift. But here's the rest of the story here. Joshua was getting the people ready to go in. And I'm telling you, he had to go into Gilgal and Bethel, but then he had to go into Jericho. And isn't it amazing that he told them, for 6 days, you are to shut your mouth. And I thought one day, God, why did you say that? And he said, because as soon as one of them opened up their mouth, they were going to start murmuring and complaining, and they were going to end up back where they had began. Yes. I was like, whoa, what a revelation. He said, I told them, shut your mouth. Don't say a word. Keep your mouth shut. Don't say a word. Can you imagine? I'm looking at her today. I'm going, could you imagine us being our mouth shut for 6 days? Shun do. My God, I'd have had to stitch my own mouth. No, just because I would want to talk, you know. But I kept thinking about that, and the Lord said, but see, now we're stepping into this next realm. We have crossed over. We have gone through. We have seen the miracles. They didn't believe Caleb is your daddy. The Joshuas. The Calebs, the Joshuas. The Calebs, the Joshuas. They didn't believe. So there were 12 that went in, governmental authority, 10. You know, the 10 that didn't believe, the number 10 means the law. And they thought, the enemy thought that, well, I'll just have everybody afraid that they cannot believe that there's this kind of fruit there and that we can't take on the giants. I just can't believe that. But are you a Highlander? Yes, God, I am. And God, if you just give me one stone, I'll take that giant down. I will take that giant down. Because that's what God's calling for. We're giant slayers. And when we grab that stone and start getting ready, see, you'll hit your enemy, and then you grab the sword and cut his head off. Because you want that baby dead. But you have to understand tonight, God has consecrated. He has done so much in the spirit realm that we don't even see the full effect of it. Nor will we for days, weeks, maybe even years to come. You're not going to know the full effect of it. But I can tell you personally, my effect is that there's been such a whoa in the spirit realm here and an awakening, and there's a hunger and there's a word that's going out, and people are listening going, you know what? There really is unity. There really is a move of God here. There really is something happening. How did that happen? But see, when you are in ministry and have a church, you have to have things done right. Because God says, on my house I will build this church, and the gates of hell will not prevail on the solid rock. And a lot of times we can have our rock, not on a rock at all, but people are building their churches on sinking sands. That's why this morning when you were given the tithe, and she was decreeing, I'm like, I'm about flipping out, jumping out of my skin. I was like, I'll take that, I'll take that, I'll take that, I'll take that. And I was like, wow, God, that's awesome. Because I had to do with finances and owning your home and getting the breakthrough and healing and deliverance. And I was like, God, when we speak, we know we set and create the boundaries. But what are you setting and creating? If you want to see change, I'm going to be honest with you, majority of all, it has to begin from within. And earlier I did an interview with Pastor Danny, and he says, you know, the one thing that keeps hitting my mind all the time is, and I had read it this morning, but if you have a heart of stone, it's amazing how the stone can kill the giant. It's amazing if you have a heart of stone and the ground is, you know, fallow. You can't plant the seed into the ground, but it's good ground here. And you can plant the seed and watch it take root and watch it grow. And you can see a move of God like you can't even believe. It's always been here. Like, I didn't do anything. I just came in. I'm a profiler and a closer. That's what I'm called. I profile the situation, I do my job, and it's a hard job. Don't think that it is not. It's a very difficult job. But if God didn't think I had it, he wouldn't have given it to me. Can I tell you, the very first time I ever preached, I dropped all my notes and said, I can't do this, and went to cry. running out, and I was like, I just can't do this. I was a substitute teacher for 2 years old. I was so scared. I was like, I can't do this. And I felt like the Lord was saying, just do normal. So by the time they came in, we were eating candy with our feet up on the wall, but I didn't know they just painted. I got in all kinds of trouble. But I was so scared. They were two-year-olds. And I was like, I made all this work. And I was like, and they're 2 years old. But I felt like God was going, yep, there you are. But he was showing me then that if you just have a childlike faith, because I know I tweak people out, but I'm like this all the time. We were out today ministering and shopping, and I found superheroes, and I was like, dan, 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 and the people, the workers are all looking at me, and I was like, oh yeah, dan, 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 because I was hearing God going, the mission is not impossible, the mission is possible. Because all you need is superheroes, but all for one. The differences in the superheroes, and it was the funniest thing, and the guy kept getting around us going, like, looking, and the kids are laughing, and the people are smiling, and we just started to release so much joy in there, but I didn't even think about it, because it's normal. That's why I was saying when I get back home tomorrow, I will have my phone, and I'm going, doo, doo, doo. It might seem crazy what I'm about to say. And then we just start dancing, picking up the luggage. And people think we're like, what the heck? That's why I said we got a little group thing going on now because I'm in the airport so much. And it's like a mob dance. It's like, I do it now all the time in different places. If I'm at Starbucks and it's like getting real demonic, I just poof, poof. And I just start releasing it. And God, isn't it crazy, right? But sometimes you can't release certain things. But then other times you can. And just because I don't maybe say Jesus doesn't mean that I can't be happy. Because people go, what is it about you that's so different? I go, oh, it's just Jesus. Amen. So I'm going to shift here a little bit because it's good. But I wanted you to know this tonight. We have crossed the barriers. I said something that I know people are offended by, but I think that a lot of people are prejudiced against one another. I don't care what color of skin you are, but I just said that earlier. I said you're just prejudiced against Mexicans. People, I can't believe you said that. I'm like, I can't believe you never have. Because we put a stigma on people, and that's got to stop. God doesn't want us to be prejudiced. He doesn't want us to be hateful, but he wants us to get ready for what's coming. I believe that the last couple days is just a taste and see that the Lord is good. But he says, get ready for what I've got coming for you. And the sky's the limit to what you can have. He says, well, you got to pray to believe to receive. And there are going to be times where you're going to look at your dream and vision and think, Lord, there is no way that I'm ever able to be able to get there. Because I keep going back sometimes and thinking when I was with the 2 years old, I'm like, God, there's no way I'm going to be able to get this job done. And Lord keeps coming back to me and saying, yes, you can. You can get the job done. Because I have equipped you with everything that you need. My DNA is in you. That's why I kept putting on the Olympics. You know, because I really wanted you to get that. My Bible's just like Shundu. But I really wanted you to catch that wind of his spirit and what it meant, because it was that powerful. It's so powerful that I listened to it all last night in my mind. I couldn't get it out of my head. I have one more thing here I want to say really quick here, but I'll just do it from here. But this is the other piece of it. So we know where we've been, we know what we've done, and we know where we're going. But I really want to talk to the dreamers right now. God is daring us to dream again. And a lot of times our dreams are being stolen and we become barren. And tonight I just want to throw this a little bit of a curve here. But I love that from Sarah to Elizabeth, there were 6 women in the Bible who were barren. Each one of them birthed a child that changed the world. And I love even Samson's mom don't even have a name. They just call, she's known as Samson's mom. And she birthed a son, even though he had issues. Thank God, because you can look and say, I'm going to be okay. But I thought about Sarah. Just go ahead and take Hagar and go have Ishmael and just go right ahead, because God's never going to move. And then he does. And he gives her Isaac. And I think about all the women that were barren. and how God moved. And then there was Elizabeth, sixth. It's man. But I thought there are six women in the Bible that were barren. And you know, when you couldn't have a baby back in those days, look what they did. They shunned you, laughed at you. You know, they couldn't stand you because you didn't have a child. They thought there was something wrong with you. But I feel like I'm giving that word for a few people right now in here that are barren. God wants you to know he's getting ready to, in the physical, open your womb. Seriously. And it's critical that you get that before I say this. And in that, I kept thinking about things like, Lord, when we come to Elizabeth, God, and she carries John, and Mary comes by, and there was a leaping in the womb. Whew. And he laid down his life. John, Isaac, all of them. Isaac in the beginning, his daddy put him up and he was going to sacrifice him because he listened to God. And I believe that it's supposed to, it's not about being tested. I really believe a little bit of a different metaphor right now. But God is wondering, will you trust me with your son? Yes, God. Will you trust me with your family? Yes, God. Will you trust me with your home? Will you trust me with your sickness? Will you trust me with your finances? If I asked you to go the extra mile, will you trust me, God says. He said, because when you seek me, you're going to find me. God wants us to get ready to dream, to know that we're not barren. Because, you know, sometimes things don't happen right away. It takes years and years to get from A to Z. And some people want it like in 5 years or 10 years. But sometimes when you look at all the times through the Word, it took 10, 20, 14 years, 18 years, 19 years, 17 years separated. Here's Saul who becomes Paul, name change. But you see, he had all that scholar in him and God had to take him out into the wilderness forever to get a lot of his stuff out of him. Still had same personality. I could probably be like Paul's sister, you know? But the point is that sometimes you feel, because you've had that dream, that you're barren and it's never gonna come to pass. But I'm gonna tell you, God wants you to know that it will. He may have to keep you out in the wilderness longer, like going around the mountain, going around the mountain, going around the mountain, more and more and more and more, because of this one thing. Because he wants you to understand that if he says he'll do it, he will. But you have to be the one that has to get that in your spirit. And we talked about this. Fear is false evidence that appears real. But faith is spelled R-I-S-K. You have to be a risk taker. I want to take you for a 30-second journey. Take a minute. Take a minute. Shut your eyes. Now, just imagine that what I just did this weekend, you were doing all the time. Can you imagine the ridicule and the stone throwing and the hate mail that I get every day? I have stalkers. My life is threatened more than I can tell you. I'm just called horrible names, cuss words from Christians. I have entire churches and denominations that are trying to kill me. Now open up your eyes. Now I want you to take a second and look at each other. If you're in it to win it, you're going to have to learn to get a tough skin. My husband hasn't got that memo yet because he says, you're my wife, you're not my pastor, and I will take them down because I'm your husband and that's my job. That's right. But you have to be able to walk in so much love and let it roll off of you. I had people since I've been here apologize to me because they don't like me. I had two people. They go, I just have something to tell you. I'm like, oh God, here we go. Okay. And they go, I don't like you. I'm like, well, that's okay. You have a right to your opinion. I'm really sorry I judged you wrong because you're real. I'm like, that's okay. Thank you. But you know, in my mind, I'm thinking you don't make me, you don't break me. Because I had to go in the wilderness too darn long to get to where I'm at right now. You have been in the wilderness too long to get to where you are right now. You can stay in the wilderness and barely get by begging for crumbs, or you can step into the promises that God's given you, you know? Or you can just do like Sarah did and give it to Hagar and just give it away. to somebody else. Do you know that there are more mantles and mandates that have been given away to other people, and this is why? Because people did not believe that God would use them. I'm so illiterate growing up, I barely could read or anything when I got saved, a couple words here and there. And I was like, God, I'm the stupidest person I've ever met. I'm so illiterate. I know 7 times 5 is 35, and because then after that, I need fingers and toes to this day. I really don't know, but I really kind of don't care. Larry's real smart, and I got him. And they have computers and calculators on everything. And I would like to have more time to be able to study, but my spiritual insight comes in a different way. And I could go to school and become a doctor or whatever, but I am a doctor. In a weird, you know what I mean? Like, I am whatever God wants me to be for that day. I'm not the best preacher, teacher, nothing. I said to Pam earlier when you were up there, I go, she gonna make us look real good, you. It's the anointing you carry. Because when you stand up, you just command. Everything gets moved in the spirit realm. And that's what I love. That's what God wants. And I can't be you. I could try. But I couldn't do it if I tried. I'd like to, but it's just, who's got time? I mean, let's get real. Yep. But you know what I learned many years ago? I did a conference, and it was the Deborah conference. Deborah's name means to be. I was so stuck them 3 days in that conference. I'm like, oh my God, Deborah's names, her name means to be. And I kept hearing the Lord saying, Ange, I just want you to be. And we started preaching and prophesying, and people were bawling. But I feel like tonight God is saying, Deborah, can you just be who I've called you to be and not care about your flags and your dancing? This is my twin as I get older. La, 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 la. I like her because she can just turn around and whop somebody with a flag and go, oh, I'm so sorry. If I do it, I get in trouble. But she just, because I'm so sorry, I'm thinking to myself, no, you're not. It's okay. Come on. We're shifting out of this. But it's important tonight. So here's the bottom line tonight. For these 3 days, we came in, we were obedient to the voice of the Holy Spirit. It was very hard. I have a lot of writing and journaling to do on this because I know it's going to be a blueprint for what's coming. And God's given you keys and me keys, but he's also given a lot of your people keys and the crossroad keys. And y'all got keys that unlock the door and set the captive free. And as long as you remember that what we just read out of Joshua 3, whether you go to this church or not, it doesn't matter. If you are around here and don't have a church, come. Trust me. Yeah, like that. Sorry, I'm getting caught up like, oh my God, this place is amazing. But it's like, but now you're stepping in. You're hungry for God. God filled you. He showed you more than ever. You're going to start having more dreams at nighttime. There are entrepreneurs that are getting ready to be released. I gave a lot of words these last few days when we did altar and stuff, and they were about entrepreneurs because God is releasing finances, and people can't believe that that really can happen. But everywhere I go, if I give a word, they all have money. Whenever I prayed for someone barren, every single time they've had a kid, I can't make this stuff up. I have no idea what I'm doing. I just know when God tells me to move, I move. But I feel like tonight, though, there's barren. God, I hope it's okay. Yeah, there's barren wombs. Not dreams, but you can't have kids. So in a little bit later, though, we'll pray for that. Because tonight's going to be different. It's going to be different. I have to be up at 1:30 in the morning, and I still have to shower and pack and stuff because I've done my job. Amen? I've done my job. Thank you. That's awesome. But I'm going to shift this here. So we stepped in Friday night. We followed the voice of the Holy Spirit. He had the Ark of the Covenant. He told us, if you will go and do what I tell you to do, Joanna, Angela, and Pam, if you just go in and do what I tell you to do and go where I tell you to go, and if you release the fire and winds of my Holy Spirit, you will see a people ignited and on fire, and you're never going to go back. words. You're only going to go forward, says the Lord. And you're going to start writing journals, and you're going to start seeing more people get saved, and you're going to start giving more prophetic words and praying for people. And who knows, some of you might even have a little happy song in the store, and you're going to just start a riot in the store with a happy song, and people are going to get so blown away, and then people start getting saved. Because can I tell you something? Joy is contagious. It is, isn't it? I think it is. Isn't it amazing, the first three fruits of the Holy Spirit is love, joy, peace. Because that's what happens when you love, you get joy, then you get peace. Of course, God says, that's how I know Christians. He told me years ago, he says, you know how you know a Christian? I'm like, by your love. He goes, no, really, how? And I go, he goes, love, then joy, then peace. You'll know them by their fruit, but he says, you'll see that in them. And so I work every day, and I just pray that I would just be the best that I could be today, and, you know, help me, Lord, not to fall or get sidetracked, because it's easy. It's very difficult when you travel and you do the work that we do in the media. I mean, I get crucified for my hair and that my lipstick's not on. Seriously. I've had people write me and say, I'm sorry, but you don't have any clothes? I'm like, huh? Not because I have holes in my jeans, honey. That's style. But they're like, because I saw you wear that jacket or that shirt or this or that. And I'm like, yeah, what's your point? But because my hair was flat in the back, and this is what I said. I said, oh, you're just jealous. Because I'm on after Joyce Myers and Benny Hinn's on after me. So I think maybe, sister, you got yourself a little bit of a problem. Because it was true. Because I had people ask me all the time, they go, how come you have so much favor? I'm like, oh. I don't know. And then I thought about it, and so I said, why do I have so much favor, God? And he said, because you're doing exactly what I'm calling you to do. And when you step from yourself and step into the promised land, and you don't care what anybody thinks anymore, except that you are radically on fire for Jesus Christ, and you are a radical witness unto him, nothing else matters. When you start leading people to God, it's contagious. Can I tell you, when I first started evangelizing, I had 76 people give their hearts to Jesus that week, and I started marking my walls. All my walls have scripture, and we have to keep painting over and other things. But I have all these, every time somebody got saved, I had the mark, and Larry goes, why are you doing that? You're playing tic-tac-toe. He doesn't know what I'm doing. Every four, you hit a five slash. And he goes, what's that for? And I go, because I'm praying every day over each one of those people. Because I don't want to get it out of my sight. Because without a vision, you're going to perish. And now we step in from the dream to this. God gave each one of us a vision. But I used Joshua 3 tonight for a reason. Because it's very profound. Because how prophetic. You can't make this up. But he also said this. But you have to consecrate yourself. Consecrate yourself unto the Lord. And he will lift you up. And some days it's harder than others. I have communion every day. And I say this is true. And then sometimes I have it a couple times a day. And they go, why? I said, because I need to. Because sometimes it gets a little bit much. And then I just go back and pray. But I've done that for almost 30 years now. And it's just a God thing with me. It's not like some people do it once a month or whatever. It's just what I do. And because I really believe with communion that you step in behind the Holy of Holies. And it's like this, that moment where it's just you and God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And you examine yourself, and then you have communion. But we have been consecrated now. We have been commissioned. We have gone from activation to acceleration. God says you have to aggressively go after what belongs to you. You must aggressively go after what belongs to you. If God's called you to be a teacher, then go learn. Be around people. I love, I did an interview earlier today with Liza and Brennan, and he said, you know, Angela, he said, I'm around people that are skilled labor. And I go, you are? He goes, yeah. He said, what should have taken me 7 years took months. I go, why is that? And he said, because if I want to be an Olympic swimmer, I want to be around other Olympic swimmers. If you want to become in business, be around other people that have a successful business and that have integrity. If you're called to be whatever, be around people that have a like mindset. Amen. And then you're going to start to see things shift, because what you're around is what you become. you will draw that type of person. And God is up to something, and it's big. But I'm going to shift here and get ready and go. But I've been very honored to be here. You just don't even know. I just so love you guys. You're amazing. And I love that you're huggers and that you're not weird and that I can just be normal. Quick story. I was in some church and a lady was in the bathroom. She had her fingers under the door and I kept thinking about Wendy and Chad when they were little. They put their fingers on the door. Mom, mom, mom. And I was going, God, if I could just have 1 minute to brush my hair without the kids. But people get weird. Don't go weird. Don't do that. Don't go weird. Just do normal. You're no different than I am. I ain't no different than you are. Well, you got a little bit more mouth than I got, but out of that, it's good. But we're not different than each other. We just are who we are. But when you start putting people up on a pedestal, that's when you're going to start to have issues. Because if you think you've had heavy hitters and you ain't seen nothing yet, God's getting ready to bring in people from all over this region. And they're heavy hitters. They live down the street from you. You just never really saw it because you're thinking, if I need prayer and get healed, I got to have Benny Hinn. If I need this, I better bring in this one. If I want this kind of fire, I better get Cash Luna. I love him. If you get this person, you have to have that. You get this person, you have to have that. No. What if you got this person, you got that person, you got that person, you got that person? Can I tell you what? You got that. And this is it. I did a documentary a couple years ago on revival. And the guy goes, yes, I just finished doing some taping with Patricia King and Bill Johnson, and he had a list. I'm like, oh, okay, so I'm thinking, why am I here? I don't know. And so he's sitting there, and so he says, Angela, can I ask you a question? Yes, sir. What's revival? And I jumped out of my seat, and I went, you're revival, and I'm revival. I am revival. You're revival. You're, say it to yourself, I'm revival. Again, that was weak. Again. You are a revival. You are a glory carrier, gun-toting, Holy Spirit fire. Like you have no idea. And that's what you need to know. If you're waiting for a revival, go somewhere else. Just get out of this church. It is in revival. Come on! Do you go to this church? Who goes to this church? Then y'all are in revival. And who knows? Maybe God's going to use you to start going somewhere else to start releasing that revival too. Seriously. You released revival in the and got good sales at the mall yesterday. Why not me and why not now? I marched to the beat of Jesus Christ. I used to prostitute and strip before I got saved. And when I got saved, I said, God, I will never, ever prostitute the anointing. I will never, ever. And I have people that want me to prostitute the anointing. I said, but I will never, ever. You can do it. You can take it, whatever you want. I will never turn on Jesus because you don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box. Each one of you has no idea what each one has gone through. You can say prophetically, just this and this. But nobody can go in to the depths of your heart and reach in and touch like Jesus can. He knows we're not perfect. He knows we're a work in progress. But he loves us, right? Oh, how he loves us so. Can we get ready to shift, put some music on? It's going to be a different night tonight. I did my happy dance. We did a war. If it's okay, I think we should pray. Is there two people here that want to have a kid? Is there anybody here that wants a baby? I know it's going to sound stupid, right? I got a couple. There's why you got your hand up? He's got his hand up like I need a baby. Can I have anybody barren? We're going to wait, though. Oh, Jesus. I'm five Hail Marys and call it a day. We're going to get ready to shift the music, but we're going to pray in 1 minute over this way. We're going to pray for that loosening, me, Joanna, and Pam, tonight. We're going to be the prayer team. And I usually do my hits the major first couple nights, And then on my Sunday, I always like to just close it differently because people want me to be put in a box and it's just not going to happen. And that was okay, right? Yes? Okay. What do you sense for, like, prayer? You can get some music up, whatever you want to do. I just want to do my job and I'm going to go.
She wants Amazing Grace guy. Joe, come on up here, buddy. Wherever our worship team is, come on it back up.
Hello. Is that you?
Yeah, this is Joe. This is our worship pastor.
All right, Pam's going over here. It never stops. If y'all need prayer, we have Joanna. She's going over this way. It's going to be her house, her prayer team, nobody else. So don't be laying hands on people and doing whatever. My job is to come in, and then I always go back a little bit further, because this is your house. So we got her over this way. I'm going to step over this way. I got my guys with me. And then if they need prayer, whatever they need.
Amen. Let me have the people that I had spoken to about being on prayer teams here at Abundant Grace. If you were asked to be on the prayer team this week, come on up. Stand up here. Partners, just a line up right here. Now, whatever you need God, believing God for, I want you to start. We can make a line right in the middle there, and you're going to come by each of us, and each of us are going to quickly lay hands on you, anoint you with oil. I'll pass the oil down. Everybody get oily, and we will. We're just going to slap it on you. And we are going to bless you and pray for you and believe for whatever God, whatever you need from the Lord tonight. If you need healing, if you need deliverance, if you just need a refreshing, if you just want more of the Holy Ghost, you want to feel closer to Jesus, come get in line because we want to bless you and pray for you. So, babe, you line them up, will you? Right there in the middle. Line everybody up for me, Jeff.
Sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. It was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. Amazing grace. Thank you. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound, saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind.